Very good afternoon, students. I, Dr. Sangamitra Das. Today we'll be talking about as we are doing international, we are doing some topics of international marketing. Today we'll be covering the topic of dumping in the international market. So, what is dumping? Most of you have heard that what is dumping. So, dumping refers to selling the foreign market at a price below the home market price. According to some economists, however, dumping means selling in the foreign market at a price below the cost of production. So, dumping is a widely used competitive strategy in the international markets. It means actually that selling a product or commodity below the cost of production or at a lower price in overseas market compared to domestic markets. Dumping is considered as an unfair trade practice by the World Trade Organization. Therefore, anti-dumping duties can be levied on imports of such products under the Agreement on Anti-Dumping Practices. A product is considered to be dumped if its export price is less than either its cost of production or the selling price in the exporting country. Besides, for taking anti-dumping action, there should be genuine material injury to the competing domestic industry. So, the government in the importing country should assess the extent of dumping and estimate the injury cost to prove dumping. So, according to Weiner, dumping is price discrimination between two markets in which the monopolist sells a portion of his product produced at a low price and the remaining part at a high price in the domestic market. So, the monopolist has the following motives for dumping: to dispose an excess stock produced due to wrong judgment of demand, to develop new trade relations with countries to benefit from economies of scale, to drive competitors out of the foreign market. So, though dumping is considered as unfair in international market, it makes sound economic sense as a profit maximization strategy. For dumping to occur, the following conditions has to be satisfied. The industry must be imperfectly competitive so that the firm acts as a price setter rather than a price taker. Markets must be segmented so as to make it difficult for the domestic buyers to purchase goods intended for overseas market. Then we talk about the types of dumping. So first one is sporadic dumping. Sporadic dumping is the occasional sale of a commodity at below cost in order to unload an unforeseen and temporary surplus of the commodity such as cheese, milk, wheat, etc. in the international market without reducing domestic prices. The main interest may be to liquidate the excess stock. So, the practice of occasionally selling excess goods or surplus stock in overseas market at lower prices than the domestic price or below the cost is termed as sporadic dumping. In sporadic dumping, the basic objective of a firm is to liquidate the excessive inventories without initiating a price war by reducing the price in the home market. So, this form of dumping is the least detrimental. Then we have predatory or intermittent dumping. The basic objective of such intermittent dumping is by way of predatory pricing is used to force the competitors to leave the market, thus enabling the predator to raise the price in the long run. The practice of predation is more common whereas the predator firm operates in numerous markets or where the potential competitors who are the ultimate victims of predatory prices and the national governments do not have sufficient information to prove occurrence of predation. The regulatory framework regarding predatory pricing varies widely among the countries. Anti-dumping actions against such dumping practices are often justified. The European countries have long been accused of dumping agricultural products with huge farm subsidies, and Japan has often long been accused of dumping agricultural products with huge farm subsidies, and Japan is often accused for dumping consumer electronics. As the strategic objective of predatory dumping is to force competitors to leave the market, this form of dumping is highly detrimental. Moreover, once the competitors become redundant, the predator increases the price. This is predatory dumping. Then we talk about long period dumping. It may be resorted to facilitate the utilization of the full capacity of the plant continuously. Operations at full capacity lowers the average cost and increases the profit in the home market. Then we have persistent dumping. It refers to the consistent tendency of a firm to sell goods at lower prices in international market. Since such form of dumping is most common, it is highly detrimental to the competing firms. So when a monopolist continuously sells a portion of his commodity at a high price in the domestic market and the remaining output at a low price in the foreign market, it is known as persistent dumping. So what are the various objectives of dumping? So the first objective is to find a place in the foreign market. A monopolist resorts to dumping in order to find a place or to continue himself in the foreign market due to perfect competition in the foreign market. He lowers the price of his commodity in comparison to the other competitors so that the demand for his commodity may increase. For this, he often sells his commodity by incurring loss in the foreign market. To sell surplus commodity when there is an excessive production of a monopolist's commodity and he is not able to sell in the domestic market, he wants to sell the surplus at a very low price in the foreign market. But it happens occasionally. Expansion industry. A monopolist also resorts to dumping for the expansion of his industry. When he expands it, he receives both internal and external economies, which leads to the application of the law of increasing returns. Consequently, the cost of production of his commodity is reduced, and by selling more quality or more quantity of his commodity at a lower price in the foreign market, he earns larger profits. Then new trade relations. The monopolist practices dumping in order to develop new trade relations abroad. For this, he sells his commodity at a low price in the foreign market, thereby establishing new market relations with those countries. As a result, the monopolist increases his production, lowers his cost, and earns more profit. Now, if we talk about the effects of dumping, the various effects it has on the importing country, and then we'll talk about the effects it has on the exporting country. So the effect of dumping on the country in which a monopolist dumps his commodity depend on whether dumping is for a short period or a long period. What are the nature of the product and the aim of dumping? If a producer dumps his commodity abroad for a short period, then the industry of the importing country is affected for a short while. Due to the low price of the dumped commodity, the industry of that country has to incur a loss for some time because less quantity of its commodity is sold. Dumping is harmful for the importing country if it continues for a long period. This is because it takes time for changing production in the importing country and its domestic industry is not able to bear the competition. But when cheap import stop or dumping does not exist, it becomes difficult to change the production again. If the dumped commodity is a consumer good, the demand of the people in the importing country will change for the cheap goods. When dumping stops, this demand will reverse, thereby changing the tastes of the people, which will be harmful for the economy. If the dumped commodities are cheap capital goods, they will lead to the setting up of a new industry. But when the imports of such commodities stop, the industry will also be shut down. Thus, ultimately, the importing country will incur a loss. If the monopolist dumps the commodity for removing his competitors from the foreign market, the importing country gets the benefit of cheap commodity in the beginning. But after competition ends and he sells the same commodity at a high monopoly price, the importing country incurs a loss because now it has to pay a high price. But a lower fixed tariff duty benefits the importing country if the dumper delivers the commodity at a lower price. Now talk about the effects of dumping on an exporting country. So when domestic consumers have to buy the monopolistic commodity at a high price through dumping, there is a loss in their consumer surplus. But if a monopolist produces more commodities in order to dump it in another country, consumers benefit. This is because with more production of the commodity, the marginal cost falls. So as a result, the price of the commodity will be less than the monopoly price without dumping. But this lower price than the monopoly price depends upon the law of production under which the industry is operating. If the industry is producing under the law of diminishing returns, the price will not fall because cost will increase and so will the price will also increase. The consumers will be losers and the monopolist will profit. There will be no change in price under fixed costs. It is only when costs fall under the law of increasing returns that both the consumers and the monopolist will benefit from dumping. The exporting country also benefits from dumping when the monopolist produces more commodity. Consequently, the demand for the required inputs such as raw materials, etc., for the production of that commodity increases, thereby expanding the means of employment in the country. The exporting country earns foreign currency by selling its commodity in large quantity in the foreign market through dumping. As a result, its balance of trade improves. Now we talk about anti-dumping measures. So the first is tariff duty. So to stop dumping, the importing country imposes tariff on the dumped commodity. Consequently, the price of the importing commodity increases and the fear of dumping ends. But it is necessary that the rate of duty on import should be equal to the difference between the domestic price of the commodity and the price of the dumped commodity. Generally, the tariff duty is imposed more than this difference to end dumping, but it is likely to have harmful effects on their imports. Then if we talk about import quota, under this, a commodity of a specific volume or value is allowed to be imported into the country. For this purpose, it includes the imposition of a duty along with fixing quota and providing a limited amount of foreign exchange to the importers. Then we have import embargo. According to this, the import of certain or all type of goods from the dumping country are banned. Then you have voluntary export restraints. To restrict dumping, developed countries enter into bilateral agreements with other countries from which they fear dumping of commodities. These agreements ban the export of specified commodities so that the exporting country may not dump its commodities in other country. Such bilateral voluntary export restraints agreements exist between India and European Union countries in exporting Indian textiles. Next, we talk about transfer price. So, transfer pricing refers to the price between related parties in an international transaction. So, it refers to the value attached to the transfer of goods or services between related parties. Thus, transfer pricing can be defined as the price paid for goods transferred from one economic unit to another, assuming that the two units involved are situated in different countries but belong to the same multinational firm. In other words, the price at which two or more divisions of the same enterprise transact with each other is called as transfer pricing. The important objectives are to maximize the total profits of the company, to facilitate the parent company control, to offer management at all levels, both in product division and in international division. In international marketing, different units under the same corporate body but located in different foreign countries exchange goods and services among themselves. The pricing of such exchange of goods and services is known as transfer pricing. A rational system of transfer pricing is required to ensure profitability at each level. Global companies, while determining transfer prices for supplies to subsidiaries and affiliated in foreign countries, take into account a number of factors like taxes and duties leviable in the countries concerned, their market conditions, ability of the potential consumers to pay for the customers, to pay for the company's product, different profit transfer rules, marketing mix, conflicting objectives of joint venture partners, and varying government regulations. Next, we talk about the various factors which influence the transfer pricing. In this, of the market conditions in foreign country, the competition in foreign country, reasonable profit in foreign affiliate, home country income tax, economic conditions in foreign country, import restrictions, custom duties, price controls, taxations in host countries. There are a number of transnational companies which have re-invoicing centers at low tax countries, popularly known as the tax havens, such as Jamaica, Bahamas, to coordinate transfer pricing around the world. These re-invoicing centers are used to carry out intra-corporate transactions between two affiliates of the same parent company or between the parent and the affiliate companies. These re-invoicing centers take title of the goods sold by the selling unit and resell it to the receiving units. The prices charged to the buyer and the prices received by the seller are determined so as to achieve the transfer pricing objectives. In such cases, actual shipment of goods take place from the seller to the buyer, while the two-stage transfer is shown only in documentation. The basic objective of such transfer pricing is to siphon profits away from a high-tax parent company or its affiliate to low-tax affiliates and allocate funds to location with strong currencies. So the reasons and the benefits of establishing a transfer price for a company is to meet the following needs of the company as a whole. To supply information adequate enough to motivate the divisional manager into making good economic decisions. To supply information adequate enough to motivate, sorry, to give useful and transparent information that will aid the evaluation of managerial and economic performance of the divisions. To redistribute wealth and economic resources within a company, that is between divisions or locations, to make sure that the divisional autonomy is protected and respected. Now we talk about the various transfer pricing methods. So the first one is transferred at cost method. So this approach is based on the assumption that lower costs lead to better performance by the subsidiary or the affiliate. So the companies using this method of transfer pricing do not have expectations of profit on transfer sale. Rather, the receiving unit, that the subsidiary or the affiliate, is expected to generate profit by subsequent sale. Then you have transfer at cost plus method. This method is applied in recognition of the principle that profits must be shown for every product or service at every stage of movement through the corporate system. But this may result in pricing that is completely unrelated to the competition or demand conditions in foreign markets. However, some companies having wide experience and information about various foreign markets use this method quite successfully. Then we have market-based transfer pricing. It is also referred to as arm's length pricing, wherein the sales transaction occur between two unrelated, that is arm's length parties. Arm's length pricing is preferred by taxation authorities, a transaction in which the buyers and sellers of a product act independently and have no relationship to each other. The concept of arm's length transaction is to ensure that both parties in the deal are acting in their own self-interest and are not subjected to any pressure or duress or stress from other party. So the pricing at direct manufacturing cost, it refers to the intra-firm transaction that take place at the marketing cost. Then we have the legal framework for transfer pricing. So the transfer pricing law in India was actually introduced in April 2001 following an amendment to the Income Tax Act 1961. Which covered intra-group cross-border transactions, and from April 2013, the provisions were extended to specify domestic transactions between related enterprise for a limited time until 2017. The law broadly aligns with the Organization for Economic Cooperation and Development guidelines on transfer pricing, that is the OECD guidelines and definitions of international transactions, documentation requirements and associated enterprise are broad and expansive. The law broadly provides methods to compute the arm's length price, extensive annual requirements of transfer pricing documentation and penal provisions for non-compliance. So, with globalization, companies are making use of differential rates of transfer pricing to optimize their profitability in low tax regimes at the expense of high tax regimes. So globally, about 60% transactions are carried out at the firm level. Countries use transfer pricing laws to stop the outflow of income from their jurisdiction by ensuring that the price at which related parties transact is at fair market value or arm's length price. In India, the detailed law on transfer pricing was introduced through Finance Act of 2001. The transfer pricing law encompasses all multinational corporations, MNCs, that transfer goods and services across borders. For instance, you can see an MNC, MNC A is Indian arm B. It undervalues the export of goods or services to A. So this would fall under the ambit of transfer pricing law as the firm's books. So these profits in the books of A, that is headquartered abroad, than in that of B, that is situated in India. This transfer pricing phenomena deprives India of its share of taxes on that income. So the law requires companies to submit details of their own transaction with related parties along with the comparable, you can say a data of similar transaction by others to justify the transfer pricing to tax authorities. So the institutional setup for transfer pricing taxation is headed by a director general of income tax, who is assisted by a number of directors in mostly the metro cities. So this was all about transfer pricing. So in the next class, we'll talk about grey marketing. Okay, students. So today, this is all from my side. So we'll meet in the next class. Thank you, students. Okay, students, now we'll talk about grey market. So what is actually a grey market? A grey market is actually, it is trade of a commodity through an unauthorized distribution channel or an unintended by the original manufacturer. So an unofficial market in which goods are bought and sold at prices lower than the official price set by a regulatory agency. So it is sometimes referred to as the underground economy or the hidden economy. This is mostly active in pharmaceuticals, electronics, automobiles, tobacco, alcohol and fashion goods. What the main advantages of a grey market is that the cost of operation is cut as no middleman or distributor is involved. The brand reaches every tangible market. The profits are usually much higher as scale of distribution is larger. The main disadvantage is that it may breach quite a few trade norms. Legal trademark goods sold through unauthorized channels, copyright laws are usually breached in this. You can see over here the diagram for the types of grey marketing channels, how the grey market takes place. So if you talk the types of grey marketing channels, the first one is parallel importing, which refers to a branded goods that are imported into the market and sold there without the trademark owner's consent in the market. This type of grey marketing takes place when a product is sold at a higher price to the authorized importer in the overseas market than the price at which the product is available in the home market. This makes parallel importing directly through unauthorized marketing channels attractive as compared to buying from authorized importers or market intermediaries. Then we have reimportation, or that is the importation of goods into a country which had previously been exported from that country. So a number of legal issues arises with the reimportation of goods, particularly where the goods were not designed for sale in the country from which they were initially exported. And the third one is lateral reimporting, where the products are sold from one export market to another through parallel importing. When the price differences exist in different markets, that makes such grey marketing channels very attractive. So the difference between prices of automobiles in the USA and Canada is substantial. As Canadian prices are relatively cheaper than there is hardly any customs tariff between the two countries, the Canadian distributors often engage in selling to the US market, for which they are not authorized by the company. So this is all about grey marketing. So grey marketing channels adversely affect the established distribution channels of the firm. Products are sold through grey marketing channels at prices lower than that of the legitimate importers and distributors. So the firms need to carefully control the prices of similar products in multiple markets. So this is all for today from my side, students. Thank you all. We'll meet in the next class. Okay, students, thank you.